I'm joined now by Richard Walker and Camilla Tomlin. Really good to see you both. Many thanks for joining us. Let's go straight to the front page of The Eye, a story that we've been covering all day here on Sky News. It's got the headlines, hundreds of tower blocks need fire checks.
Indeed. I think a lot of the papers obviously carrying a similar theme to main stories in the papers tonight, this and Theresa May's EU Citizens Pledge, which we'll come on to. But just the notion now that, I mean, aside from the concerns about cladding being on other buildings, and this does predate really the public inquiry. We don't actually know, but we're making assumptions, probably quite rightly, because of the speed of the fire, that the cladding has been to blame for its quite, you know, tragic and horrendous spread across this particular building, that other buildings may be also, you know, at this great risk of fire. And we were trying to work out in the green room, you know, I suppose perhaps a blame game at this stage isn't particularly useful, because what's needed right now is to protect other residents of tower blocks from this happening again. But there is this sense of confusion as to how on earth we're in a situation where these tower blocks have been covered with basically lethal material.
That's the thing. Now, why would you make combustible cladding in the first place?
I don't understand that. I also don't understand how there supposedly were 16 safety checks by Kensington and Chelsea Council of the tower block in question, and they somehow missed the fact that the cladding was combustible. Now, I'm not sure about whether or not the combustible cladding was breaking any rules. I don't understand why. And if they miss it in Kensington, have they missed it in these so far 11 other tower blocks? It just seems incredible to believe that's the case, that there's somehow something so dangerous has been just not picked up across the country. It seems ridiculous to believe that's the case.
Residents in three tower blocks in Plymouth have today been told that the cladding on their tower blocks is combustible. The horror when you find out that information, it's terrifying.
Well, even if you hadn't found that out, actually, I think since this happened, anyone living in a tower block anywhere is probably feeling very worried and worried about fire escape routes. You know, we're not in an Americanized system where you have fire escapes on the outside of houses and big tower blocks. Equally, this whole sprinkler suggestion, you know, none of these tower blocks having sprinklers if they're pre-1980. Having said that, my brother's in the construction industry, and he says that quite a lot of modern tower blocks don't have sprinklers, because if there's a fire on one level, all the sprinklers go off and the whole building's flooded, and then nobody wants that, and for insurance reasons, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't know whether this merits a whole-scale look at our entire fire safety system. We were having a bit of a ding-dong backstage about the notion of attributing blame, yes, to councils, but equally, what's the fire brigade's role been in this? Changes that were made to this building, £10.5 million worth of changes, were signed off by the fire brigade. That's what happens when building regulations take place and experts are brought in to ask whether this was safe or not. Equally, this public inquiry needs to look at the fact that seemingly the fire brigade went in, put out this fridge fire, left, and then it went up again in flames. That needs to be analysed, surely.
That's true. But and yet there was only one fire escape. I mean, surely the council should look at that. Somebody,
I know, but that would have been put in.
Common sense suggests that one fire escape probably isn't sufficient.
But then you're talking about what? Do you go back to the original architect of the building and say it's your fault you only put in front one fire escape? I mean, there's clearly a chain of events here that have led to catastrophe.
You've also got to ask the question why the recommendations from the Lackenall fire in 2009 wasn't acted upon.
Yeah, sure, at a higher state level, and Theresa May took responsibility both on a state level and on a local level for some of the failings. It doesn't change anything for the victims of this fire or this tragedy, does it?
But presumably now, tenants that live in the tower blocks that have been identified as having the same sort of class, they'll need to be rehoused, and that could be thousands, tens of thousands.
Yeah, the Telegraph makes this point, doesn't it? So the Eye's obviously using that stark image. Actually, I was speaking to a taxi driver today who drives past it every day and just saying how horrific it looks, and it's like this monolith to absolute tragedy. Mm. What will happen to this tower now, who knows? But for the people living around it, for the people living in similar accommodation, it's just probably doesn't bear thinking about. But the Telegraph, as you say, Richard, making this point now that thousands of people are going to have to be temporarily displaced so that this checks can be carried out of their buildings, cladding can be removed. I mean, from a housing perspective, it creates a nightmare scenario.
In the ideal situation, they'd be housed within their local communities, but is that going to be possible if you've got so many people being forced out?
Well, I think in London they were given assurances that they would be housed locally, but I think, as far as I can tell, those assurances have not been adhered to, so there's a lot of anger around that as well. And I think as well as the safety issues, I think there are some other issues definitely around about the kind of social divide in London and in other cities, indeed, between the rich and poor, and how it looks in many cases, it can look as if the living premises of poor people are not given are not looked at enough to make sure that they're safe.
But on that housing point, though, agreed, people who are displaced should be rehoused in the local area. They've got kids at school, they've got families around them, they've got friends, they've already been through a horrific time. Having said that, what's the solution if there simply isn't the housing available? Do you then turf other people out of their housing and move them on? What's the solution to that? There's been a lot of criticism of the council. We've got council waiting lists at an all-time high, not just in London boroughs, but across the country. I'm sorry, what's the solution?
I think the main criticism of Kensington and Chelsea Council seems to be that they weren't talking to people properly. I think if there was
do you do if you don't have the stock?
I think you're honest with people, and I think if there was a problem housing people locally, then you discuss it with them. Then you don't give assurances that they would be housed locally and then break them. I think that's another breakdown in trust at a time where trust is in short supply in this particular case.
It's just that there's been a lot of criticism, but no real practical solutions to the notion that, well, if the housing isn't there, you go as close as possible, but physically we can't build new flats for these people. I understand, though, today there's that block of luxury flats, I believe, on Kensington High Street that are being made available and hopefully will be finished by the end of July, which is obviously a step in the right direction.
Well, let's hope there is a resolution that comes out of the public inquiry. Let's move on to a different story. This is on the front page of The Times. This is about Brexit. The Prime Minister's been speaking to other European leaders. You get the sense that this is a bit of a sweetener, what she's offering European countries as the negotiations take place.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because we were expecting more of an announcement of this over the weekend and a paper's being produced on Monday. But clearly they've brought this kind of, as you say, bit of good news forward. David Davis had made no secret that this is going to be the first thing on the negotiating list, this notion that there would be a quid pro quo in terms of it being mutually beneficial for us to retain the EU citizens we have here. I don't think anyone who voted for Brexit wanted to see European citizens marched out of the country, for goodness sake. But equally, to suggest that actually the 1 million Brits living abroad also need to have their rights to remain guaranteed.
It's fair enough, isn't it?
It's absolutely fair enough. I think she should have done it far, far earlier. I think it leaves a bitter taste that people's lives and livelihoods are kind of used as pawns in a negotiating ploy. I think it was obvious that this was going to happen. She should have done it earlier on.
But the EU weren't going to guarantee the Brits living abroad, were they?
Well, I think the EU would have done that.
Gone in and said, we will guarantee EU citizens here without any guarantee? Of course, it makes common sense that they would reciprocate. But what if they didn't? What do you then say to British expats living on the Costa del Sol? We've played our hand, we've showed our hand, we hope the EU will reciprocate. But what if they didn't?
I think there was very, very few signals that the EU would not reciprocate.
Want to discuss it until now, did she? They went to her earlier and said, shall we discuss this earlier?
Well,
she said no.
Brexit was prompted by the British government. I think it behoved Theresa May to behave in a humane way and say that these people should be allowed to stay in this country before getting involved in all the negotiations.
But when you say you think that the EU would definitely have guaranteed the right, was there really any serious doubt that the British government was going to turf EU citizens who had got a right to live here and work here and contribute out of the country?
Well, there clearly was some doubt because she refused to give a guarantee that
there wasn't any doubt, then why would Dave Davis just not say, fine, they have the right to stay in the country?
Exactly.
Well, no, but there's a sense that you're saying that it's absolutely a given that the EU would keep and protect British citizens and citizens there, like giving them the benefit of the doubt.
Do you know what? Even
and
if
not suggesting. I mean, who?
Do you know
who,
what?
There'd be riots in the streets if British people, either if they voted for Brexit or didn't, suddenly started seeing people being marched out of the country.
I don't think it would be right.
But that was quite a lot of the scaremongering that was brought about by Project Fear, this kind of notion that that would happen. You know, people have been living here for years, would be asked to leave.
There are right things to do and there are wrong things
but
to do.
But she's doing
this
it now.
Case,
just, I find
late,
this posturing.
It's not posturing. It's just the right thing to do was to give a guarantee.
But didn't she go to Merkel and say they wanted to resolve this earlier?
Hopefully it's the right thing to do, and she's doing it in the national interest, which we've heard from her time and time again. Stay with us. That's it for this segment. Lots more to come, including the school uniform hot weather process that's gone viral. What's that all about? Hello there, welcome back. Richard and Camilla are still here with the pages. This is a story which is in the Times, page 2. This is about police cuts and serious concerns from senior police officers.
Indeed. Richard?
I mean, I think clearly we don't want to make the resourcing of the police difficult. They have a big task. But it is important that there is a watchdog in place. It is important that we spend enough money to make sure that it's transparent and that the police are held accountable. So I'm not convinced that taking money from that area and putting it into the police is necessary. And I'm not sure it's necessarily a good thing.
It's interesting because it's come from the chief of the West Midlands Police, who have lost a number of officers. They've got fewer officers now than they had in 1974, and they're going to be below 6,400 officers by 2020. He's making the point, I guess, that, you know, adding 30 million onto the budget of the police scrutiniser is not necessarily the best use of money. It obviously comes against this backdrop of 20,000 fewer officers that haunted Theresa May during the entire election campaign. Yeah. Under her as Home Secretary, stripping down numbers. Having said that, I do have a little bit of sympathy for the argument that actually requisitioning police and replacing them in different areas, especially when we get onto the next story about Russian hacking and the notion of police perhaps not being on the beat anymore. I think we get nostalgic about bobbies on the beat, but there isn't necessarily... Are they best served, so-called, on the beat when actually more crime is now being committed, for instance, online, or there's more need for people to be investigating terrorists than perhaps there are shoplifters?
But
I don't know.
The argument
is
eyes and ears on the ground, isn't it? You know, that direct contact with members of the local community.
And it makes communities feel safer to see police officers on the street because they think there's somebody looking out for us.
But are they safer?
Debatable. Yeah. But, I mean, I think the notion that if you cut back on the watchdog, therefore there will be more money for counter-terrorism, and I think is a bogus argument. I don't think those two things are related. I think there's, I don't think it would necessarily. I think counter-terrorism seems to be, and it's not awash with money, but I'm not sure there's many people saying that the resourcing issue is a crucial one there.
Yeah, maybe after the success of Line of Duty, we're all quite into the police investigating themselves.
Yeah, absolutely.
Indeed. And Camilla, you mentioned Russian hackers. This is a fascinating
story. This,
Minister's
actually.
Passwords up for sale. It's been traded, apparently.
I know, and this is a Times investigation by the Times data team, which is a sign of the times, this digitised age we're living in. But, yeah, essentially finding that the emails and passwords used by people like Justin Greening, Greg Clark, foreign ministers and heads of state, the Director General of the Department for Exiting the European Union, no doubt, perhaps his password is Brexit123, have all been hacked by Russians seemingly intent on subverting our cabinet in any way they can.
It is like
intriguing.
Something out of John le Carré novel.
It's a very, very modern crime, although if they're anything like most people I know, the ministers will have changed their passwords three times before the criminals get their hands on them, because you have to do that regularly anyway, and I forget mine all the time.
I know, and you have to... Sorry, it is a serious story, but then speculate as to what some minister's passwords would be. Jeremy Corbyn's password, I hate TM, asterisk, explanation mark, John McDonnell, dayofrage.com. The mind does boggle.
Yeah, hopefully not after their birthdays or anything as simple as that.
Yeah, or just PA55 word.
But it does talk to the fact that no matter how secure you think your systems are, it's always seemingly possible to hack them.
Well, indeed. And the perpetrators seemingly coming from the same country when it comes to these stories.
Indeed. Story in the Sun, page 7. These young boys wearing skirts. 21st century, the girls can wear skirts. Why can't the boys?
Richard would like to call them kilts, wouldn't you, Richard?
Yes, they look quite like kilts, actually.
Somewhat tartan.
Indeed. Personally speaking, if someone had told me when I was a pupil of that age at school that I had to wear shorts at school, I would be out in the streets protesting about that. I was quite happy with long trousers, thank you very much. But yeah, it's a bit fun, isn't it?
And also, I think this is gender equality at work in 21st century Britain, because I've got girls at my children's school that ask to wear shorts because they're tomboys and they don't like wearing skirts and they're allowed. So equivalently, why shouldn't boys be able to wear skirts if they want to?
Yeah, I saw an article, I think it was yesterday, a similar thing, but in the working environment. Men who said it was way too hot to be wearing trousers, they came into work wearing their wife's skirts and dresses.
Well, to put my royal hat on, I was at Ascot on Tuesday, and I did feel very sorry for some of the poshos, who I don't usually have that much sympathy with, in their top hat and tails. It looked rather warm compared to the flowing that the ladies were wearing.
I think the headmistress of this particular school has said that she might now look at it again, she might allow shorts. And amazingly, she allowed the boys to loosen their ties.
Oh, lucky them. Rock and roll.
Clearly, standards are slipping.
Breakthrough. Richard, how would it turn out at work if you rocked up in a dress or a skirt?
Well, I know if any of you that I employed rocked up in a dress, I would be challenged.
Don't staff at the National wear kilts on occasion. Burns night.
It's not part of our uniform.
No, fair enough. All right,
no,
fair enough.
Absolutely not.
I'm slightly disappointed by that. I'd like tartan clad staff at.
Clearly, we would absolutely welcome anybody that wanted to do so, but we don't lay it down in our contract of employment on Mondays and Thursdays. You must wear a kilt.
Richard, Camilla, many thanks indeed for joining us.
Thank you.
Always entertaining. Let's have a look at what the weather's got in store for us.
As showers wash over the UK, Australia soaks up some fun in the sun.
Breezy day on Friday as outbreaks of rain sink slowly southwards across the UK and Ireland, followed by bright spells and blustery showers. Much of Scotland, Northern Ireland, Islands, Northern England and North Wales will have the cloudy, wet and windy starts of the day, while further south it will be mostly dry with sunny spells. Many southern parts will remain dry, bright and breezy during Friday. Elsewhere the rain will turn light and patchy as it slowly sinks southeastwards across the UK and Ireland.
The weather, sponsored by Qatar Airways.
Let's stay with this on Sky News. Still to come, the latest on the investigation into fire risks in high-rise buildings across the country.